on the subject of variable inductors and capacitors, this is an idea I had a few years ago, or a year ago. I haven't told a whole lot of people about this yet. This is my idea for one way to do a variable inductance. So what I did was I got a glue stick and I took the inside out of it. I took the glue out and I cleaned it out on the inside, and I wrapped about 10-11 turns of magnet wire around it. And then on the inside, you have the mechanism that pushes up the glue. Let me just get that out for you so you can see what is in it. Right there, let me see if you can get it closer here. If you can see that, there's a ferrite ring tucked right in there. It's just the right size, and it fits right in there as, you know, a friction fit. And it stays in there really nice. You could probably glue one in there if you can't find one that fits perfect like this, and it's probably going to be good enough. But I don't know, this plastic is like designed not to stick to glue too well, so you probably have to use that special kind of crazy glue, or super glue, that has that additive in it that allows it to stick to plastic, like you know, the gummy slippery plastic like polyethylene and stuff. But anyway, that's just what I did on the inside. So the way it works is, and some people have taken to calling this the glue stick variable inductor, or the glue stick, they're using it in something. It's a type of VFO, I forget exactly what it's called. And it turns out that this is actually really good for that, because you don't get a wide variance in inductance from this. You know, it'll only vary maybe a couple of microhenries at the most, depending on what kind of core material you use. If you use 43, which you can get away with on the low bands, on the HF bands and stuff, then you'll get a lot more, because 43 has a high permeability. So if you use a high permeability core, you'll be able to get a little bit more of a swing in inductance. But I don't have one. I didn't use one in this prototype, but you know what I mean. So if you need that, but this is actually the way this is, it turns out that it's good enough for use in a VFO, like a Hartley VFO or something, where you put a tap in the coil. It doesn't have to be 10 turns. It could be whatever you need to get the inductance you need. Just you have to space it so that it's not too large, so that the ferrite core isn't always inside of it, and you only have so much space to work with on the outside of the glue stick. Here, I'll show you. I'll turn on my meter here, and right now the low side of the inductance scale is at about 3.6 microhenry or so. So we'll start turning it in, and it'll start rising. And then it stops at 4.0. And earlier I had it for, you know, for some reason, I don't know if it's because these are crossed or what, but it was going up as high as 4.5. The low end would be 3.6 and the high end would be 4.5 microhenry. And I was originally going to use this in an antenna tuner, and it could certainly work for that as long as you have the right core material and everything, and it's shielded. It should be shielded if it's an antenna tuner, just to keep radiation from, you know, make sure the radiation is happening in your antenna and not in your antenna match. But you won't have a whole lot of variation with this the way it is, you'd need a high permeability core. And if you can get one of the long bead cores that'll fit, if it'll fit in there and you can get it glued in, that'll work a lot better for that. But you have to make sure that it's right for what band you're using it on. And here's the other thing that'll work for this. It's a deodorant. It's a dry stick deodorant. And you just, when you're done with the deodorant, you got this and you can clean it out. And you can see how this is large enough that you can actually even put the coil inside of here on a form like a cardboard tube or something. And you can see how I had this core kind of slipped over this. On this one, there's like a little length of tube section to it, and you can slip it over that. It doesn't stay very well. I think I was going to glue it or something, but never ended up using this one. So there's a number of different home care products you can get that have this type of screw push-up type thing. You know, it's a brand of ice cream that used to come with this too. There's a few different products that use this type of packaging, and then you can reuse it when you're done. You can reuse it as a variable inductance. And then I want to show you this. Now, this was my idea for a variable capacitor, and I made this little antenna coupler on 2 meter band. I got a little farther with it, and then I decided I wasn't going to use it. But in here, you can see my idea for the variable capacitor. And what I used was just a little length of this polyethylene tubing, and then I wrapped some foil tape around the end. Let me get a little closer in here so you can see it better. So I have this length of polyethylene tubing, clear polyethylene tubing. It's a quarter inch inside diameter, and I have going into it a brass screw, and the brass screw, the nut on the brass screw on the inside, is soldered to the box, and that provides the ground connection. And then the screw is actually one of the capacitor plates, and then the other capacitor plate is this foil here on the outside. And you can ignore this. This is just some plastic I used to try and hold this down and keep it from moving around in here. And I used a soldering iron, I used my wood burning tool to melt the plastic in here so it would stick. And I matched the type of plastic and everything to polyethylene. They're both polyethylene. So anyway, but the important part is down here. So as you turn the screw goes further and further into the tubing, and until it comes into line with the foil tape on the outside, and then the two form a capacitor with the polyethylene tubing as the dielectric. And now I forget what, I haven't used this in a while, so I forget what exactly the capacitance was of this. But it varied a lot. This one actually worked really well, a lot better than the inductor. Let's see, I can hook it here, I guess. Yeah, all right. And then somewhere on the case, maybe like right here, the outside of this connector. All right, turn on. Okay, so right now you can see that it's reading, I hope you can see that, it's reading 14 picofarads. Might be kind of hard to see. I hope you can read that. So I'll start turning it out. I'll start unthreading it. So now it went up to 15 for some reason. It's kind of hard to turn. Now we're 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, 18, So the bottom end of the range, the tuning range, is about 8.3 picofarads. And then the top end is 15. Right, 15. Right. It goes up quite high. There's a considerable tuning range to it. It's not fantastic. It's not as good as maybe an air variable with the interlacing leaves, but this has a higher dielectric strength, don't forget, because the tubing is thicker than the little tiny space between your capacitor leaves and an air variable. Can get almost to 16. I think it would go almost to 20 picofarads. You're gonna have to take my word for it because I don't have a screwdriver right here with me, but there you go. I mean, that's my idea for the variable capacitor, and it works. It's a piston type variable. It's a piston type variable, but it's built up using some very specific components. And since the dielectric material is polyethylene, this is good even on VHF, maybe even UHF. So that's pretty good. And that's why I used the clear poly, or the white, which is about as high of a grade as you can get. And the higher the grade of dielectric, of course, the higher frequencies it'll tolerate, and the higher the standoff voltage will be and everything. So anyway, this has been the Antenna Farmer, and I hope you maybe get some ideas of your own, or maybe this is helpful to you. Don't forget to rate, comment, and subscribe, and leave a comment down below. And I will see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.